challenge that India has in its import-export policy and in economic development is the fact that we don't have a very large ESDM industry. The ESDM imports are now possibly the second largest after oil, and I'm told they're going to overtake oil sometime in the next 10 years. Last year, we had about $160 billion of oil imports, and we had about $40 or $45 billion of ESDM imports, including a lot of telecom equipment. This year, of course, oil imports would possibly come down to something like $80 billion, with exports of something like $30 billion, and net, we're going to shell out about $50 billion. So next 2 years, if the oil prices don't increase, we could possibly see ESDM overtake oil as the single largest item of import for this country. And it's a bit of a shame for India because we were leaders at the time of independence in electronics in this particular area, and we have systematically destroyed our advantage in this area, like because of bad policy, lack of implementation, lack of, let's say, infrastructure, and understanding the ecosystem for ESDM. World over, the ESDM ecosystem has developed because of many, many reasons. We all know that the ESDM requires an active component manufacturing base. It requires a mother industry, like the chip industry, which will use this active component base so that they could quickly turn out these components. Assembly is a large part of this. It requires an efficient supply chain. And the markets have become global. We saw how ESDM transferred from the United States to Taiwan when they set up USMC at TSMC. And the Taiwanese government came with this plan to set up good quality infrastructure in Taiwan, an industrial area with assured power, with a little bit of subsidies, and help an entrepreneur who came back from the United States, created that industry, and soon Taiwan became the center of this industry in a very large way. And then over a period of time, this industry dissipated in Southeast Asia and finally has landed up in China, where the government provides subsidies, government provides infrastructure, supply chain efficiencies, etc. But this industry has become extremely concentrated. It's a concentrated industry. And it has concentrated industry because there has to be a number of component manufacturers and who will make sure the components are manufactured as per the product requirements. There has to be some other industries which produce those chips. There has to be a whole sort of designers who come and help in this design, and it has to flow through seamlessly. There has to be makers of jigs and all kind of templates so that it could be done very seamlessly. And all this requires intellectual capability, design capability, manufacturing finesse, and very, very high quality facilities. And this is something which is very, very expensive. And we have seen now in the last many years that fabrication and design are separated. In the United States, I think fabrication plants have come down and they've gone away to areas where people don't bother a lot about return on capital employed or return on capital, and government subsidize a lot of the stuff and they become very expensive because their plants are $5-6 billion. And innovation is also stuck up primarily because, you know, people don't recover enough from this huge investment within a short period of time, as innovation drives various new products to come. And this kind of an ecosystem is now divided into design and in manufacturing. And in design in Bangalore and in India, we have a very large number of designers in this particular area. So we don't lack much in the form of design, but what we lack much is in templates, we lack much in creating the basic building blocks, we lack much in the infrastructure, which has to be very, very high quality, with no power interruptions and requirement of large amounts of water, and also supply chain efficiencies. You'll be very surprised that supply chain costs 13% of GDP in India, whereas in the United States it costs about 5%, and in China, 6%. When you talk about supply chain, the ability to seamlessly distribute components, both imports and exports all around the world, primarily through air, maybe through water, and maybe through road, in a very seamless manner without being stuck up in this checkpost or somewhere like that by people who don't understand what is inside. And very often, small parts have a huge value, and nobody can find out within these packages as to which part is there because the technical expertise is available with no government in any part of the world. So this is the kind of ecosystem, and this is the kind of ecosystem that exists today, which India has to look at very carefully. And so the government of India has come down with the ESDM policy, Many of you, I think, participated in the creation of this policy. The state of Karnataka has come out with this policy, and many other states here have come out with this policy to create this kind of infrastructure. So I would like to ask members to tell us for 2 minutes that in their state, how do they see the ESDM ecosystem, and what have they done to make sure the ecosystem comes up? What kind of support in terms of infrastructure, supply chain efficiencies, lesser government interactions they give? What kind of inputs they're giving to train people to work in this kind of ecosystem, and who are those entrepreneurs who are coming? So I'd just like to give 2 to 3 minutes to each of them to explain to you, and then we'll ask other questions and get along. Sir, we'll start with you.
Good evening to the people on the dais and also my friends, ladies and gentlemen. I'm the principal secretary IT in Government of Odisha. We had, as you are aware, Odisha has the most preferred destination in the year 2012 and 13 when compared to all other states. Now, we had a huge mineral potential. I mean, so if you see 1/3 of the iron ore, 1/3 of the coal, and nearly 50% of the bauxite, nearly 100% of all those rare minerals are available in Odisha. We had done very fairly good in the mineral sector. That could be a foundation for the growth of all of the sector. Coming back to the ESDM, we had a look at that. We had now looked at what kind of incentives which are available in the policy space in other states. And we have seen the Government of India this thing also. We are coming out with a kind of policy guidelines which are attractive, especially the capital subsidies, and also the various kind of incentives they are looking at. It could be entry taxes, it could be power, this thing, it can be this thing. We are in advanced stage of discussion with a few of the people from the China, and some of them are from the US. We are in advanced stage of signing. We are offering this against a huge infrastructure park which is coming up in Bhubaneswar. So these are the two things. We are already in advanced stage. If anybody is interested, we would like down to one-on-one case basis. We can sit together and offer the incentives. That's what.
Have you gone to countries around the world like Taiwan and China to benchmark what you're going to offer in terms of infrastructure?
Yeah. In fact, the principal secretary and my colleague Mr. Vishal, who runs of the infrastructure development. Can you show your hand? So he has gone and then he met a discussion, and we know fairly, we map what is their expectations, and then which are much above what we are actually currently offering in India, by the way. So we are trying to match that kind of this thing. So we had a first hand knowledge of that.
Yeah, Mira.
Good evening, everybody. I had the advantage of my minister preceding my speech, so I think Karnataka's early bird advantage, the ecosystem that is already in place, gives us at a very advantageous position. And in spite of that, Karnataka government has not been complacent, and it was amongst the first states to have the hardware policy, and in 2013 we had the KESDM policy set in place right after the National Electronic Policy was put in place. The Karnataka ICT group that was defined, which was led by, of course, Mr. Pai himself and industry stalwarts, and they had defined a roadmap for us, and it was to occupy 10% of that $400 billion that has been talked again and again, and 20% of the exports, which is around 16 billion dollars for Karnataka itself. So overall, we are looking at a 2020 target of meeting that $56 billion to be feeding to the domestic as well as export industry. And to achieve those, we have defined the policy very clearly that in spite of the ecosystem that is already there, we are ensuring that there are capital subsidies available for the exports to make the companies competitive in that regard. There are sufficient duty drawback policy that is there. For innovation, we have substantial policy in terms of patent filing, reimbursement to a substantial extent, for ensuring that the companies can market themselves outside of the country. Substantial marketing incentives are being given in addition, the Science and Technology Directorate is putting best efforts to ensure that the ecosystem which is driven by talent pool is in place. So all in all, it's a very holistic policy, and I think we are on track in ensuring that we meet the targets.
Thank you, sir.
We are expecting the guidelines from the other states also, and Bangalore, Hyderabad, they are too much ahead. That's why today I'm here to get the guidelines from you guys. And now we are opening the Hinjawadi Park, the IT park, which is already boosted in Hinjawadi, and we had kept a land for the or electronics part also, and when defense group, they are coming to Hinjawadi, and we are providing the lands as well as the infrastructure for them. But till our Maharashtra policy is to be opened, and we are just following the other states.
Yes, sir.
My name is Aman Singh. I am Principal Secretary IT and Principal Secretary to CM and also of Energy Department. Government of Chhattisgarh. You all must have heard about a place called Naya Raipur, which is the first greenfield capital city of 21st century. It is a city of 237 square kilometer, where we have earmarked an area of 80 square kilometer exclusively for IT and electronics. You'll be happy to know that we have already invested more than 6,000 crore rupees there. We have express highway of 150 kilometers already laid there. In fact, it is a city which can match any city in the world as of now. It has underground and all components of smart city, SCADA lighting system, of course 24/7 power. We are willing to give land to anybody who is wanting to set up an electronic or IT unit with a rebate of almost 80% on the premium. You also have the advantage of early bird. If you come and you want to invest in year 2016, you get a benefit of additional 10%. I am sure you must be aware that Chhattisgarh is the only state in India which gives 24/7 power even to agriculture consumer. So we give uninterrupted quality power, and our cost of power is 45% less than the national average cost. So there is no other state which can compete on this. We produce 30% of India's aluminium, 30% of India's steel, 15% of India's cement. So you will have a huge cost differential in the fixed cost. You will have an equally advantageous cost differential on the operating cost. As far as the policy framework is concerned, apart from this, we have recently brought a new policy which was approved by Cabinet only last week,